Kickoff at the RCA Dome just moments away. Let's hear from the coach of the Tennessee Titans, Jeff Fisher, who's down on the field with Andrea Kramer. Andrea.
Thank you very much. Well, Jeff, the guys were talking about the unusual circumstances surrounding this game. How will you work it with almost a different game plan for the first half and the second half?
It's not a matter of having two game plans. What it is, it's a matter of being able to adjust. That's all it is. As coaches, we do that week after week after week. You know, if a player's down because of injury, whatever reason, you have to make adjustments. So we couldn't, out of fairness to our players, we couldn't come out with two game plans. We say, this is what we think is going to give us a chance to win, and we'll adjust if we have to.
Vince Young has had tremendous success running against the Colts. How big is that in the plan tonight?
Well, I mean, it's very important. You know, our best chance of winning offensively is using both his arms and his legs. He's very excited. He had a great week of practice. He understands he's going to have to improvise because they're so fast on defense. So he's going to have to do some things with his legs.
All right, Jeff, thanks for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, Andrea, and take a look at that as far as the injuries are concerned. Kevin Mawai, the only injury of note for the Titans. Their starting center out with a calf injury. But Harrison with the knee. Anthony Gonzalez, their top draft choice, with a toe. UTEC, a tight end who sees a lot of action. Deem is a starter. Mathis is a starter. Brock and Bethea as well. But all of those guys are expected to play in 2 weeks. So that's a case of if tonight were a playoff game, you would see all or at least most of them. They're also minus, of course, Dwight Freeney, who got hurt in early November in San Diego and is on injured reserve. With flash balls popping, here we go. Tennessee to get the ball. Chris Henry to field at the 5-yard line, and Henry gets taken down in the open field by Melvin Bullitt, a safety who'll see a lot of action tonight as he backs up Antoine Bethea. From the 21-yard line, here's White, who cuts it back, and the first play of the game, a promising beginning for Tennessee on a 13-yard run as he cuts it back and is tackled by Bob Sanders.
You know, this is a thing that you can do to that Colt defense. You're talking about how fast they are. Watch the defense. You start that way. That whole defense goes that way. The Titan offensive line just pushes them down, and then Lindale White comes to the backside. See, that's what happens. Anytime you get an end running up the field like Josh Thomas does there, you're going to give a big hole to him.
And here goes White again. His first run was good for 13 yards, and this one a little bit longer, good for 15, out to the 49-yard line. So back-to-back runs by the former USC Trojan, who played in the same backfield with Reggie Bush for the national champions a couple of years ago.
You've always been able to do that to the Colt ends because, you know, they want to rush the passer. They get out wide, so they'll get up the field. So that'll give that weak side 4 and 5 hole to you all the time.
Two tight end set here. And once again, they call White's number, and White bowling balls his way across the 50-yard line to the 48. Sanders, as exciting a defensive player as you'll see in the league. And once again, this is White, a steady dose of him. He takes it to the 44-yard line. So White, stopped by Charleston, creates a 3rd down and 3 with Vince Young in his third year going over to the bench to get the call here. I don't know if his headset is not working or not, but he gets the call from the bench. As you take a look at his career in 3 games rushing against the Colts, as you can see, 9.7 yards per rush. That would be great per pass as well.
Yeah, and when you talk to the Colt defense and what they have to do, everything is to stop Vince Young.
Out of the shotgun on 3rd and 3, he sidearms it underneath to Bo Scaife, his college teammate, tackled there by Bob Sanders, and that's a first down. So 3 successive first downs on the opening drive for the Tennessee Titans.
You know, the Colts don't blitz a lot, but they blitzed on that play. I mean, they were trying to get to Vince Young before he could get rid of the ball, and he gets back there. They pick up the blitz perfectly, and he gets the ball off to Bo Scaife. You see, the pressure was coming from his left side, and he had Scaife, his tight end, to the right side.
Chris Brown is now the running back. He is the tailback in this set. Ahmad Hall is the fullback. And it's a quick flip that's a little bit behind the receiver, but he's able to make the catch. And it's a gain of about 8 yards on Young's throw to Roy Dell Williams, who is their leading receiver. Williams catching his 50th pass of the season.
You know, Jeff Fisher was saying that Vince Young was excited about this game and ready to play, and the way he's starting out here, he sure looks like it. You know what they do? They have a good plan for him here. You know, run the ball, play action, throw those short, quick passes, the slants, those kinds of things.
Second and two. This is Brown. And Chris Brown, fifth year out of Colorado, third-round pick back in 03, picks up the first down. Ramon Guzman, the rookie out of Buffalo, making the stop for the Colts.
You know, the strength of this Titan offense is the offensive line. And that's where, you know, Jeff Fisher talks about this group right here and the job that they do. And so far you can see that. They have really taken control of the line of scrimmage.
Lendale White comes back into the game. He's carried four times for 35 yards. Young out of the shotgun. And he's going to hand the ball off to White. And this time he'll get stuffed as he crosses the line of scrimmage by the middle linebacker. Gary Brackett, number 58. It'll be second down and nine.
You see what they did, Al? They went three wide receivers that time. And Jeff Fisher was saying that they want to run out of that sometimes. You know that, you know, get them, you know, think pass, show them a passing formation, but run out of it. That time it didn't get Gary Brackett at all.
White behind the fullback, Hall in the backfield on second down and nine. 5 minutes into the game on the opening drive of the game. And another slant, and that is caught by Byron Ealy, a rookie from Houston. So Ealy, who's seeing some action over the past couple of weeks, winds up making the first catch of his career.
And you see what they did. The Colts came on a blitz that time, so he's going to have a free lane to throw that slant. So the corner is man-to-man, but I think when you're man-to-man and you have a blitz against these guys the way they're going now, you should get up and press them, get up a little tighter. I think the cushion was too big, and they just gave him that slant on second down.
Titans trying to pick up their fifth first down, and they will as the catch is made by Justin Gage, and he'll take the ball to the 9-yard line, setting up a first and goal. And the collective groan you're hearing right now is coming from Cleveland.
Justin Gage is a big guy, you know, and that's what Vince Young likes about him. That's what Norm Chow, the offensive coordinator, likes him. You know, he's a big physical guy that doesn't get a lot of separation, but when you can jump like that, you don't need as much separation.
Titans win, they're in, they lose. The Cleveland Browns go to San Diego next week. First and goal from the 8-yard line. And a big hole over the right side for Chris Brown, who takes it in for the touchdown. So a near perfect opening drive for the Tennessee Titans as they come out smoking hot. From their own 21-yard line, 11 plays, 79 yards, 7 rushes, 4 passes.
Yeah, we're talking about the offensive line and how they zone block and they get good leads and they control the line of scrimmage. To me, this drive was all about the offensive line dominating the line of scrimmage and Vince Young making good throws.
Rob Baronis for the point after. And so they control the ball for 6 minutes and 19 seconds. Brown to the end zone, and the Titans up 7-0. Downtown Indianapolis on this cool night, temperature in the 30s. And again, the Dome hosting its final regular season game. There'll be at least one playoff game here, and then next year across the parking lot, they'll go to the new Lucas Oil facility. Rob Baronis to kick off. And from the 1-yard line, this is T.J. Rushing. Escapes the tackle at the 15. Brought down at the 22-yard line. And that's where the Colts and Peyton Manning take over for the first time tonight. 8.5 to go in the quarter. 7-0, Tennessee. A decade ago, Peyton Manning, the number one choice overall in the draft, started his first game as a rookie. Hasn't missed a start. So tonight, 160 consecutive starts from Manning. Every start in every game in which he has been in uniform in the NFL. Manning swings it to the outside. That's a dive, and the dive turns it back up, gets to the 30-yard line. It'll be second down and two. For the record, Brett Favre with the almost untouchable streak, you would think, at 253. But if Peyton can stay healthy, he figures that Favre's going to retire, we think, before Manning does, we might have a shot at it.
Yeah, and it's just, you know, amazing that, you know, a guy can, you know, play every game for 10 years, you know, what Brett Favre does. And these guys, you know, it's not about an offense, but these guys still take hits.
And on second down and two, that's Wayne who makes the catch. And Wayne, of course, has become their primary guy, with Harrison missing so much action this year. Harrison played in the first four games in the season, only one since, and so Wayne has really emerged.
You know, he's even taken Marvin Harrison's spot out there on the right side. Marvin Harrison is usually, you know, the right end. Reggie Wayne is the left. With Marvin Harrison on, they've been playing Reggie Wayne more as the right wide receiver.
That was his 93rd catch, and that pass is incomplete, in and out of the hands of Brian Fletcher. He was popped by the linebacker David Thornton, the former Indianapolis Colt.
Yeah, they knew one thing, that on Kyle VandenBosch over here in the left side, that they were going to have to get a chip. They were going to have to help their tackle Tony Hugo. That time, Joseph Addai got what you call a real chip. That was chipping off a big old hunk. VandenBosch right down.
Put him in the wood chipper. Halfway through the quarter, second down and 10. Manning a short drop into the outside, and that is caught. Third down and four from the 40-yard line. Manning up on his toes, and that's Wayne again into Tennessee territory to the 41-yard line. Stopped by Cortland Finnegan, and that's an 18-yard pickup, and he's already called on Wayne three times for 28 yards.
You know, I think what you just said, Al, here is Peyton Manning up on his toes is a reason that he's played 160 straight games. He's always on his toes. He's never flat-footed. He said he's like a boxer. You're always on your, you're always ready for a blow.
To the outside, here's Wayne trying to set up a pick for him. Thornton grabs him by the ankles and takes him down at the 38-yard line. That'll be a gain of four as Wayne makes his fourth catch.
Reggie Wayne was saying, you know, I can see what Marvin likes about this right side out here, that if that's where Peyton Manning looks first, he can throw those slants and fades quicker to his right than to his left.
Wayne closing in on 100 catches. He's four shy of that right now. And this is caught by Clark, and Dallas Clark is taken down about a yard and a half shy of the first down by the rookie safety, Michael Griffin. It'll be third down and one.
What they're doing is they're playing a cover four here, four across on Dallas Clark. And you see him, he's just in the slot, and that safety can't get up there. I mean, he's waiting for him to come deep. When he goes short, that safety has to get up there, but he does a good job of getting there and getting Dallas Clark down before he gets a first down.
Third and one, Manning out of the shotgun. And that is caught. That'll move the chains. And that is Devin Aroma Shadu making the catch. Finnegan has really emerged. Meanwhile, Haynesworth has been battling a hamstring pull and has played not that much lately, as Wayne drops the ball, and it's recovered by Tennessee. Michael Griffin popped him. We talked about the rookie. He was the number one draft choice, played at the University of Texas, and he's the guy that dislodged it. David Thornton, the ex-Colt, comes up with the recovery after the fumble. More groaning from Lake Erie. On NBC, after the fumble, from the 20-yard line, the Titans start with White again, who had a good first drive, takes it up to the 25, and he's stopped there by Josh Thomas, who will play tonight in place of Robert Mathis.
You know, one of the things this Tennessee Titan offense does is they understand this Colt defense, and they know that the big part of it is Bob Sanders. And they like to bring Bob Sanders down, you know, in the box, eight man in the box. They're bringing him up weak all the time. But the Titans are doing a good job of getting a blocker on him, not letting him run free and be the free tackle.
And this time, Brown, who scored the touchdown out past the 30-yard line to the 31, picks up a first down. So the Titans doing a lot of running after Indianapolis had done nothing but throw the ball in their first series.
Well, you know, you see this zone blocking and this offensive line, again, all working as one and good hard running. Like I said, this Titan offensive line is really dominating and winning the battle at the line of scrimmage. Therefore, you can run because you're getting first down.
Two tight ends set here on first down. This is Brown trying to get to the outside, and Freddie Kiao says, not this time, pal. Down he goes behind the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, that's what you have to do. That zone blocking, we were showing how the Titans were zone blocking. You have to get penetration. And watch right here. Ed Johnson is the guy that gets it. He gets it started. He gets that penetration, gets it in the backfield, and then Freddie Kiao can come and finish it up.
He took care of Eugene Amano. He bowled him over. Amano is the starting center in place of the injured Kevin Mawai.
Ed Johnson canned the center, huh?
Yes, he did.
He canned it.
Second down and 12. The fake. Now Young. And he'll take off for the first time, but not very far. And he starts to stumble as he goes down. And Gary Brackett was there to give him a little bit of a pop. Young couldn't get down on this old turf. As you take a look at Young out of the University of Texas, he led them to the national championship over USC a couple of years ago. Only player in league history with as many yards in each category in his first two seasons, closing in on 1,000 rushing yards.
This is going to be tougher going here for Vince Young when they get in third and long, because this is when the Colts get in their nickel and play that deep cover two with two deep safeties.
On third and 11, Young is flushed out, but he's going to run. Not enough, though, for the first down. He gets tackled by Marlon Jackson on the outside. That time it was Keontae Dawson who flushed him out of the pocket.
Now you see the run is effective. He's here in the shotgun. Look at that lane on the left side. He sees it. He can pick it up. He points out there, get that guy blocked. But, again, he had to go about 11 yards to get a first down.
Craig Hendrick, 14th year in the league. One of two holdovers from their Super Bowl team following the 99 season. The other, the guard Benji Olsen. T.J. Rushing collects this one at the 8-yard line. And returns it to the 17 with a minute and 20 seconds remaining in the opening quarter. The Titans trying to win a trip to Southern California on top, 7-0. Next week, right here on NBC, the Redskins getting in with that 4-game winning streak at the end of the season. Jacksonville, Pittsburgh, a rematch of a great game played in the snow a couple of weeks ago. And right now Tennessee just trying to be a part of that wild card picture. A win tonight, then they go to San Diego. They lead 7-0, and here's Manning starting his second drive. He was 8 of 9 for 58 yards, and here's their first running play of the night. And Adai with a big hole and a first down. And Adai gets out past the 30 to the 32-yard line, tackled by Lowry, 14-yard gain.
Yeah, I don't know how Albert Haynesworth ran right by him. I was watching Haynesworth, and that's what you want to do on a line of scrimmage. You want to get penetration. He gets penetration. He doesn't even see Adai. Adai has to make a move. He gets the ball, boom, right there now. He has to get away from Haynesworth. Once he does that, he's on the second level. He makes a loop move on the second level, and boom, he's on that third level right now.
320 pounds, but he still has a strained hamstring, and he has strained it again. Injury timeout. Take a look at that with Albert Haynesworth, and they're working on him in the lineup. They allow 79 rushing yards a game. They allow more than double that in the three games without him. 9-3 when he's played, 0-3. So with and without, with or without you, with apologies to you too, they can't live without him.
Anytime you get a big guy like that that dominates the inside, he's going to basically take away the inside run from tackle to tackle. And that's what a healthy Albert Haynesworth does.
Randy Starks takes his place, number 90. And now through the middle, they try to exploit it with Joseph Adai carrying the ball out to the 35-yard line. It will be second down and 6.
And now they can exploit it with the run because they don't have Haynesworth in the middle. Plus, they're playing a cover two. Now, once you play a cover two, you're playing with a seven-man front. And these seven guys right here have to be able to hold up against the run. If they can't, you have to bring a safety down.
On second and six. That pass is caught by Fletcher, and he gets popped short of the first down. Nick Harper, the former Colt, and he goes down. So Harper will need some attention as the quarter comes to an end. End of one, Tennessee leading Indianapolis 7-0 in the final game of the 2007 season. Sunday Night Football resumes after these messages. Start the second quarter in Indianapolis. Al Michaels, John Madden, and Andrea Kramer. Peyton Manning, first 10 seasons, 160 consecutive starts. Remember, Favre didn't start as a rookie. In fact, he was an Atlanta Falcon. Manning with 105 wins in 10 years, 10.5 per season, 306 number of touchdown passes, 30 per year, and most attempts and completions. And he's, well, he's really in the prime of his career right now. Nick Harper is back in the game, and Albert Haynesworth is also back in the game. The two guys have needed attention at the end of the first quarter, and we begin the second period with Joseph Addai carrying up to the 48. Among other things tonight, Peyton Manning goes over the 4,000-yard mark in passing. The season he has done that.
You know, and the thing is, he has great mechanics and great techniques, and he's a very bright guy who works as hard as anyone can at this game.
From the 48-yard line. Swings it out to Wayne. Wayne will gain 9. Reggie fumbled on the first drive, but right now he has caught 5. And, you know, one of the things they like to do when you have a milestone that's within reach is get it. And right now Wayne has 97 catches, and they'd like to get him those other 3 if they can.
Yeah, he likes this now. I mean, Reggie Wayne's playing on this right side and Marvin Harrison's spot. And when they go to the slot with a wide receiver, he's the slot guy.
And they go to him again, and that's 98 for him as he takes it to the 35-yard line. Again, as we talked at the top, John, you know, we figured we would see these guys for a half, maybe less, but certainly in the second half, at least Manning figures to be done.
And that's Peyton Manning throwing again to Reggie Wayne on the right side. And Peyton says that he likes to throw those slants, and as I said earlier, the ups, because he can see them quicker and get them out quicker. And that's the whole thing about Peyton Manning, getting the ball, reading the defense, getting the ball to your playmaker.
From the 35-yard line out, this pass is caught, and that is Wayne, and Wayne takes it to the 30-yard line. And for Reggie Wayne, a lot of short stuff, a lot of underneath stuff. That would be 8 catches as they go no huddle again. So he had 92 coming into the game. It gives him 100 for the season and a 14.8 average, though it's considerably less than that tonight.
Right, and this Titan defense is just playing soft, and they're playing too deep, and they're giving them the slants, or giving them some of the inside run, or giving them some of the shorter inside passes, but they're not going to let them get the easy, quick, cheap one deep.
Play clock down to 2. Manning on 2nd and 5, and that is caught again by Wayne. So there is all that easy short stuff underneath. Reggie Wayne with 9 catches in the first 18 minutes of the game.
Right, and he's caught him all over the place. He's caught him as a left end. He's caught him as a right end. He's caught him in the slot. But again, he's big and strong, and he's physical. And he's against, you know, Cortland Finnegan there, who's a physical corner. So you have 2 physical guys at the line of scrimmage going after each other.
And again in the slot, Clark tries to get a block down, but it's only to the extent that a 2-yard gain is made by Wayne as David Thornton makes the catch, actually giving close to 4. It'll be 2nd down and 6 at the 20-yard line.
You know, it was interesting talking to Peyton the other day. He wanted to come out and just throw the ball. And again, he thought he was going to have Marvin Harrison, but you know, he didn't want to, you know, run the ball much, but Tennessee knows that, too, and they're giving them tough defenses to throw deep on.
And this time it's Tulloch, the middle linebacker, who is there along with Travis LeBoy, stopping Joseph Addai in his tracks. Addai over 1,000 yards this season. Earns an invitation to the Pro Bowl. The ball is at the 19-yard line, and it will be 3rd down and 6.
I think that's what the Titan defense wanted to do, is just hold off this offense while Peyton Manning's in there, and then go to work on Jim Sorgen. And maybe let him move the ball, you know, let him have that underneath, let him have that short stuff, but don't let him get easier quick touchdowns.
A die out, Keith, in the backfield, flanking Peyton Manning on 3rd down and 6. Pressure, and Manning gets hit as he throws. His arm was hit by Travis LeBoy coming around the corner, the fourth-year end out of the University of Hawaii, and so the drive bogs down, and in comes the field goal unit.
And Travis LeBoy can do that. He's a pass rusher, fresh guy. They bring him in on the 3rd downs, and that's the thing. I mean, if you're not going to get the guy, then get the ball or get his arm.
Adam Vinatieri, take a look at that. The average length of a field goal kicked by Vinatieri this year, 27 yards. That's the lowest in the league since 1973. This a 37-yard attempt, and this one is good, so that average will creep up a couple of tenths. 10:40 to go in the half. Tennessee fighting for its playoff life on top, 7-3. Different kind of Motown, home of the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, and there is a Danica Patrick sighting at the RCA Dome tonight in Indianapolis. Seven to three. The Titans on top. Chris Henry takes it at the 5-yard line and brings it back out to the 22-yard line, where Vince Young and company will take over. 10:35 remaining in the opening half. The Colts this week re-up Bob Sanders, signed him to a very lucrative long-term deal, and why not? He's about as big a force on defense as anybody in the league right now, as Young off the play fake throws, and the catch is made by Ben Hartsock, a former Colt, and that's a big gain out past the 40. They'll spot the ball at the 42-yard line. That's a gain of 21 yards.
Yeah, that's a play that you can do. It's just a play-action pass. You see, you fake in there to line, get the linebackers up, and then where the linebackers were supposed to be, you put your tight end in that hole.
From the 42-yard line. Now to give the ball to Brown. He picks up 3, 2nd and 7. Let's go down to Andrea Kramer.
Well, as you say, not only is Bob Sanders now the highest paid safety in the NFL and the leading candidate for Defensive Player of the Year, but he's very humble. I asked him, what was your reaction to the extension? He said he was with his mother. He said when they told him the figures, he couldn't believe it. He kept saying, are you sure? Tell me again. Tell me again. He just couldn't believe it. It's sort of nice to hear that from a player today.
Bob Sanders, who grew up idolizing Barry Sanders. And Bob was a running back in high school, then started to play defense when he went to college at Iowa. That's a gain of 1 for Brown, and Sanders is there to make the stop.
Well, see, here he is up here, but he plays a lot of times like a linebacker. We talked that 8-man up, the 8-man in the box, and he's up there. Now, the Titans have been doing a pretty good job of blocking because they know that's what Bob Sanders is going to do. He's the eraser. If anyone in the front seven make a mistake, he's going to be the guy that will come up and make the tackle. And, boy, he has it. I mean, he has strong explosion and a short distance, better than anyone I've ever seen.
3rd down and 6. Young pulls it down, then throws. That's caught by Gage, and the former Chicago Bear gets taken down, but not before he gets to the 35-yard line and gains 20 yards on the play.
You know, Vince Young has been making big plays in the passing game against the blitzes, and that's what you see. He gets a blitz here, gets a pressure now. When you do that, when you bring one, that means that you're going to have less downfield. So a guy like Gage can just run a crossing pattern. And Vince Young is so tall. I mean, he's like 6'5", 6'6", and he can see over that. I mean, here's the pressure coming, but he gets up on his toes, see, and his toes also, and he can see everything downfield.
Young is 6 for 6 for 72 yards. And now he's going deep. And that pass is incomplete, but a flag comes in, and you're going to get interference called on Marlon Jackson on the pass intended for the rookie Byron Ealy. First penalty of the game. Ron Winter is tonight's referee.
Pass interference. Defense number 28. Penalized at the spot of the foul and a first down.
I always like it when you don't mention the referee's name until you're about 22 minutes into the game.
Yeah, that's always a good thing. Watch Marlon Jackson here. The way that ball is thrown, it's thrown high, and I think that it looked like both the receiver and the defender kind of misjudged it.
Field judge makes the call. It's first down and goal. It was a 25-yard penalty. And now the ball is loose as Brown loses it at the 7-yard line. Colts think they have it, but they normally do. And they do. It is official. Ed Johnson created the fumble, the rookie free agent. Darrell Reed with the recovery. A lot of cheering in Cleveland at the moment. 7-3 Tennessee. Well, that will be the scene in all likelihood for the rest of the night. Manning 14 out of 16. He's going to come out. And so the fate of the Cleveland Browns, as a die comes out as well, rests with one Jim Sorgi. Dallas Clark is out too. From the 7-yard line, Sorgi will take over. He'll hand the ball to Kent and Keith. And Keith will swing to the outside. And Keith will pick up 12 yards on the first play that Sorgi calls. Luke Lawton, number 45, led the way with a block, a first down, and a penalty flag.
You know, that was one of the things that the Colts said, that when Sorgi comes in, they're going to play more two-back, less three wide receiver, less two tight end.
Illegal block in the back, number 80 offense. Penalized half the distance to the goal. Repeat first down.
Devin Aroma should do, number 80 with the penalty.
What will happen, you see Aroma Shadu right there came in. That was just a dainty little push.
Yeah, right.
And that's what he should be penalized for. If you're going to come in and block the doggone guy.
Yep.
If you're going to come in and give him a dainty push, the official should call a penalty on you.
Anything dainty should be penalized. First and 9, because they moved it back from where the penalty was, and that pass is incomplete. So, you know, it's kind of funny the way all these games are played out this weekend. We saw Tom Coughlin play it all the way to the end along with Belichick last night. That was phenomenal. Today, a lot of teams have rested players. Indianapolis resting a lot of guys. Now you got Sorgi in the game. We're going to see a lot of the backup guys, and the Cleveland Browns just have to sit there and hope.
Right, and, you know, Tony Dungy says that just because we're doing this, that doesn't mean we want to lose the game. We're not going to give them anything. I mean, we still want to play this game, play it hard, play it fast, and win it.
Luke Lawton has become a crowd favorite. They salute him with his own Luke call. Takes it to the 14-yard line. And that will set up a third down.
You know, that's what Tony Dungy and Bill Belichick, you know, are a lot alike. I mean, you say, how's Tony Dungy like Bill Belichick? They're two totally different guys, and they are, but they do well at plugging guys in. They do well at getting guys ready to play other positions before they need them. They do well at making these kinds of adjustments.
Third and 4 from the 14-yard line. Sorgi, who played at Wisconsin, throws, and that pass is caught by Reggie Wayne. So Wayne stays in the game. The ball is at the 19, and one reason Wayne stayed in the game is he now has more receiving yards than anybody in the league. Prior to that last completion, he was tied with Randy Moss at 1,493. That's good for 5 yards, so it's 14, make it 6 yards, 1,499 at the moment for Wayne. Moss second, Chad Johnson third.
And he's the go-to guy in this game plan. I mean, you know, as I said earlier, they're playing him out here at right end like they are now. They played him in the slot. They played him at left end. Wherever they want to throw the ball so far in this half, they just put Reggie Wayne in that position.
From the 19 now on first down. That pass is caught. There's Wayne again. So Wayne has caught a dozen passes and we haven't played 25 minutes.
You see, what did Sorgi do? He learned that from Peyton Manning. If you get in there and if you have Reggie Wayne, just move him around, but wherever he ends up, watch him and throw him the ball. Now I don't know what he's going to do because they just took him out.
They just took him out of the game. He was saluted. He already with a career high tonight in catches for a game, 12, and he does that on a short night's work, relatively speaking.
And I think when you don't have a Marvin Harrison, you better be sure you have Reggie Wayne.
Now you've got Kenton Keith as he takes the inside give out of the shotgun for a minimal gain to about the 33-yard line.
Don't you feel that this Tennessee Titan defense is just starting to tighten up on everything that, you know, against Peyton Manning, they're always worried, you know, he's going to go deep. If you give him anything, you know, he's going to always find that deep guy. Now I think with Jim Sorgi, they're starting to crowd the line of scrimmage a little more. They're starting to clamp on the underneath stuff, believing that he is going to throw shorter passes.
Ainsworth still out of the game, working on his hamstring earlier. So far, this has gone almost exactly the way Jeff Fisher had hoped it would at the outset. Second down and 9. Sorgi will throw, and he's under duress, and the pass is incomplete. Fisher talking about the fact he wanted to get off to a good start. He wanted to use the clock, and he did that on that long opening drive, which resulted in a touchdown. He didn't want to give up the big play to Peyton Manning as long as Manning was in there. He just wanted to keep this thing really close until Sorgi got in there, and that's exactly what he's done.
Right, and then hope that you're close in the third and fourth quarter, and then you win it then. And maybe he's even doing a little better than that. You know, I think that he just wanted to, you know, maybe not be ahead, but just be close at the point when Peyton Manning goes out.
Third down and 9. Haynesworth is back in. That pass is caught on the outside by Crofonzo Thorpe. And that gain will only take it to the 34-yard line and set up a fourth down and 8 as the clock ticks down to 4 minutes remaining in the opening half in Indianapolis.
That's what happens to these quarterbacks that only throw short passes. But watch Albert Haynesworth here, 92, trying to run. He's probably running about one quarter speed. And old Jake Scott, the old guard, took advantage of it too, didn't he? Anytime you have one of those defensive linemen flopping around like that, you can get a free hit on him, you always take it.
Hunter Smith to do the punting. Chris Davis, a rookie out of Florida State, backs all the way up to the 7-yard line. And a flag gets thrown, which will take that one back after he gets out to the 26-yard line, but it will come back toward the Tennessee goal line with 3:42 remaining in the first half.
During the return, holding number 31 of the return team, penalized at the distance to the goal, first down.
Cortland Finnegan, 3:42 to the half. Titans lead the Colts by 4. The other was in Edmonton in 2003 that drew 57,000. Who knows what the weather will be like? They're expecting blustery winds, and obviously it'll be very chilly. It'll be a great scene New Year's Day on NBC. The NHL outside with Sidney Crosby and the Penguins at Buffalo as Lendale White begins this drive with a gain of 1 up to the 9-yard line.
Yeah, we talked about Bob Sanders and, you know, what they're doing with him and like that extra linebacker. They keep bringing him up as the eighth man in the box all the time, and they're bringing him up weak side. And then if they stop the run, then he'll go back and be a deep safety and play in cover two. Here on second down, he's up again right here. And again, that's to stop and take away the run.
And Young has to get it away in a hurry, and that's incomplete. And it would figure Bob Sanders would be right in the middle of the action. Rocky Boyman, a former Titan, came in, put the pressure on. Bo Scaife was the intended receiver, and he could hear Bob Sanders.
Right, well, he's right up here, and he can do a number of things. He can play the run. He can play this short pass like this. And the other thing he does is he spies on Vince Young. And if Vince Young starts to run, Bob Sanders is going to be right there on him.
Hear him and feel him. Third and 10.
Right now they're in nickel. 5 defensive backs to the Colts.
Vince Young has a knack of bringing his best when the games mean the most. When Vince Young steps in the huddle tonight, everybody's going to have full confidence in him, knowing that he's going to create his magic.
I know that if we can keep it close, if we can get the ball in Vince Young's hand with an opportunity to win the game late, you know, I like our chances.
And it may come down to that here as Young took a timeout. Tennessee taking a timeout preparatory to a third down at 10 with 2:58 remaining in the half. Chris Brown flanking Young in the backfield. Out of the shotgun on third down and 10. Here come the Colts, and he gets it away, and the pass is incomplete. Flung it over the middle, intended for the tight end, Bo Scaife.
And that was the time that it didn't work for Vince Young. He'd been very successful anytime the Colts would blitz. And they came on a blitz this time, and he just couldn't get it to his tight end. But see that overload on the left side? And Scaife just didn't get open him, and there was nothing there.
Craig Hendrick to punt. So that good punt by Hunter Smith, and the penalty on the run back, and a three and out should give the Colts some fairly decent field position as Hendrick feels the low snap and then really booms one to the 32-yard line. Rushing out past the 40. Stays in bounds into Tennessee territory, but there comes the flag at the end. Sooner or later, you'll see yellow, and he takes it to the 41-yard line.
Now you see a bunch of yellow. There's a yellow here, and there's two yellows side by side there. So something happened at the left 40, and something happened at the right 45. Now the guy that was at the right 45 just threw his in the pile with the others. We got laundry all over the place.
It's like they're anti.
During the return, illegal block in the back, number 42 of the return team. A 10-yard penalty, first down.
Brandon Condren, the block in the back.
You know, you look here at the right side of the screen right here, and they had two of them. They could have taken either one of those. Maybe that's what they did. That's why they had three flags out there, because one did come out later.
Three flags is never a good sign for the return team on a punt. I know that.
Because it's always going to be on them, isn't it?
Yep. Right, times three.
In the old days, it used to be clipping, though. You
right.
Know, clipping on the return, now it's blocking in the back.
I miss clipping.
Yeah, I do, too. Right, good old-fashioned clip.
As long as we're not the clippy. Sorgi steps away from pressure, and then that pass is knocked down. Double team, good coverage there. The safety, Calvin Lowry, second-year safety out of Penn State, to knock it away.
You know, Jim Sorgi just signed an extension. And, you know, it's one of those things. In fact, he said it's a double-edged sword. On one hand, you want to play. I mean, you're a competitor, and you want to play, and you're playing behind Peyton Manning. But that's a good thing. You're playing behind Peyton Manning. You know, and he's one of the best and one of the top two quarterbacks in football, and you're learning a lot. He said, by the end of the contract, I'll still only be 30 years old.
Second and 10. Sorgi's backing up, and nobody can get open, and the pass is incomplete, and there is a flag down at the 33-yard line.
You wonder who's calling the plays.
And there's a man downfield. Number 57,
like could be
offense.
Manning.
The penalty's declined. Makes it third down.
That was Dylan Gandy. Well, normally it's Tom Moore as the offensive coordinator. And, you know, Tom, and we've talked about it every time we've had the Colts, that he gives Peyton concepts.
Yeah, but I think Peyton has given Jim Sorgi concepts. Look, he even got the old deal where he's hiding his mouth when he does it as the play call sheet. I mean, Tom Moore could give him to Peyton, who gives him the Sorgi.
Concepts plus, third and 10 from the 31. And that pass is in and out of the hands of Clifton Dawson. And so it's fourth down. This has to be so agonizing for the Cleveland Browns to watch right now, knowing that, you know, their playoff fate is in the hands of the Colts. You can't blame the Colts for doing what they're doing. They have to think about themselves. And yet you're sitting there in Cleveland going, oh, man.
Yeah, but the Browns put themselves in that position. I mean, had they won one more game, they wouldn't do it. I mean, they gave Tennessee life, and now Tennessee has to come in and win this game, and they're in the playoffs. And the way they're playing, I mean, they look like a playoff team, the Titans do.
Hunter Smith's punt fielded at the 10-yard line by Chris Davis. And he'll get taken down at the 17-yard line with 2 minutes and 13 seconds remaining in the opening half. And now Moore will sit down with Sorgi.
You know, and I'm sure that he's showing him the pictures and showing him that the defense is tightening up on him. They're not playing the same defense the way they played when Peyton Manning was in there. It was a looser defense. You had the slants. You had some of those things. Now they're tightening up everything, knowing that Sorgi isn't going to throw deep. I think what he has to do is he has to get some deep throws in against him to loosen that defense up.
Lundale White is the running back in the set at the 18-yard line. And White, who was a workhorse in the first quarter, picks up a couple. Bob Sanders makes the tackle. And that will take us down to the 2-minute warning. That much time remaining in the opening half. Tennessee needs to win to get to postseason play, to win a trip to SoCal, and they're up by 4, 7-3.
Al, have we ever gone to a stadium where the fans wear more of the team's jerseys than here in Indianapolis?
Indianapolis, I would say Kansas City. Well, they all wear red, not necessarily the team apparel. Second and 9. And that pass is deflected and caught by Gage. It was Bo Scaife who had it deflect, and then it winds back after the pop by Matt Giordano in the arms of Gage. And all things considered, that's a 21-yard gain, but it was Scaife who got whacked on the play, and he is down.
Again, Vince Young from the shotgun here. Pretty good pass protection. Now, that's a tough throw there. He throws it over the linebacker in front of the safety, and his tight end takes that hit, and look what happens. Boom.
Now, I don't want to bring anything up here, John, but every time I see a play like that,
I know exactly what you're thinking. I am too. Except Giordano not only hit Scaife, but he hit the ball with his head. Knocked his hair off and everything. Yeah, no, I know what you're thinking. Yeah, you're thinking the Oakland Raiders, Pittsburgh Steelers in Pittsburgh.
So the question, you know, here it is, as we talk about what's known as the Immaculate Reception back in 1972. Bradshaw. And then Harris will wind up with the ball. And, of course, in those days, the technology wasn't what it was today. But, you know, John, you've seen it from every angle that was available. If there was or had been replay during those years, what do you think would have happened?
I don't know. I mean, I think that, you know, they probably would have said that it was a double touch because, and, you know, I mean, the play we just saw is a legal play, but in those days it wasn't. If it touched one receiver, it couldn't come off that receiver and another guy could catch it. That was a double touch. Double touch wasn't allowed. Now, this is a double touch, but the double touch is allowed. I don't know. I mean, at some point you have to, they tell me you have to let it go, so I let it go.
Because we're when like last Tuesday?
No, just 2 minutes ago.
That's what I thought.
When I saw that, because that was my first thought. I saw that, the old double touch, that's illegal. No, it's legal. You know, I don't know.
It's only 35 years. That's okay.
Let it go.
On first down now, the pass is caught by Gage, and he is out of bounds. Meanwhile, because of that injury, and it took place in the last 2 minutes of a half, Tennessee was charged a timeout, so they have one remaining. One timeout with a minute 42 on the clock and a first down here at the Indianapolis 47. They work on Scaife.
Yeah, Scaife took a real hit on that. I mean, that was a pretty good throw, but it's a tough throw against the cover two, where you get it over the linebackers in front of the safeties, because if you get the ball in there, there's going to be a collision shortly thereafter.
Ben Troop takes the spot of Scaife. Young. And he'll step out of bounds in front of the Tennessee bench at the 43-yard line. Second down and 5 upcoming.
You know, if those guys that Vince Young points to get a block would get a block for him, he'd take a lot of yards. I mean, he had Eric Moles out there one-on-one, and he points, go get that guy. If you block that guy, I'll get by the rest. Mm-hmm. Eric Moles didn't get that guy blocked.
Well, I always find that to be dubious. Anyway, the guy has his back to you, and he knows who he's supposed to block. There's only one guy out there.
Well, I think, you know, at some point he's running a pass pattern, so he has to change from a pass receiver to a blocker.
This is Roydell Williams, and did he get forward progress? Yes. It's enough for a first down. Tackled there by the corner, T.J. Rushing, and it's a first down at the 36.
You know, one thing that's impressive in tonight's game is the tackling. It's very good. It's very crisp. It's hard hitting. You can tell that this game is a playoff game for the Titans, but you can also tell it's a division rivalry game.
And that pass is incomplete, and it will be second down and 10. Before we get anybody mad at us in Green Bay, we were talking about a stadium where you'd see more team jerseys. I talked about Kansas City. Green Bay would be another one, too, where almost everybody comes with Packer colors, at least.
Yeah, they all come number four. But here I think they have more jerseys. You look, it's either a blue jersey or a white jersey. But I think there's more Colt jerseys at a Colt game than any other stadium.
Could be. And throw Pittsburgh in that mix, too.
Just an observation. No, I don't want to make anyone mad either.
Right.
I just look, and it's all blue and white here. That's all you see.
Second down and 10 from the 36-yard line. Young, Chase, and they're going to get him on the outside. And who else? Sanders.
Yeah, you know, we talked about that, you know, that Bob Sanders is going to be up there. And what's he doing up there? He's up there for the run. He's also up there to spy Vince Young. When Vince Young starts to run, Bob Sanders goes with him. And I don't know that there's anyone that I would rather have as a spy on a quarterback than number 21.
Agreed. And he's 5'8 and 206 pounds.
And I think he's the defensive player of the year. Someone asked me the other day if he is. And I said, well, if I had a vote, I'd vote for him. I can't think of anyone that is better or does more for his team than Bob Sanders does for this defense. Look at some of the plays that he's made this season. You know, and talking about that, you know, explosion in a short period. You know, I mean, watch it. I mean, right there. I mean, he just makes explosions. I mean, he's like a boxer with a punch. I mean, and that punch just like that is like a knockout punch. Very, very powerful.
Now it's third down and 15. Sanders back in coverage on this play. Young trying to step outside. Throwing deep, and the pass is incomplete, and that was Sanders, as we said, back in coverage. So this guy, he's just everywhere. He can blitz. He goes to the outside. He's a run stuffer, and he goes 40 yards downfield to help bust up a play.
Yeah, that's the thing that they'll do is he'll play up there when you need a run stopper, and then when you get on a passing down, then he's going to be the deep safety and rove from side to side. And whatever he's doing, whether he's at the line of scrimmage, in the backfield, or deep, there's going to be a collision when he gets there.
Hendrick will punt. And he will sail that one with some backspin. It bounces at the one and comes back, and they'll down it at the 6-yard line with 35 seconds. So instead of a touchback and out to the 20-yard line, and maybe you take a couple of shots downfield to move into field goal range, Indianapolis will start this drive with a little more than a half a minute to go at their own 6.
I think Jeff Fisher, as you watch him there, I think he does an excellent job because, you know, you look at this roster and the offense and the defense and you say, you know, who are the players? You know, who does he have here? And there's not a lot of guys that really stick out as superstars. And, you know, I mean, he has the two defensive linemen, Vince Young, but it's just a team. I mean, he gets them to play well as a group.
Fisher has been the coach since November of 1994 when they were the Houston Oilers. Longest tenure with one team of any current coach in the National Football League. And he got the half he wanted because he's got Manning out of the game. He's got a die out of the game. He's got Harrison in street clothes. Wayne is probably done. Some of the defensive guys are done, and his team has a 7-3 lead as we go to the halftime break. So coming up next, Bob, Chris, and Keith on the Toyota Halftime Show from New York. And you'll see those guys right after these messages from your local NBC station.
mindset going into the game is that, you know, it's do or die.
Unlike last year, we had to wait for four teams to lose out. This year, we control our own destiny, and that's what we plan on doing.
The last couple times we played these guys, we played them tight, so we know that we can beat them.
Some say Indy has nothing left to play for. They've already locked up the number two seed, and they got nothing to win from this game. This is the NFL. Everybody plays to win.
We're ready to get to that first playoff game and get out there and feel that intensity of the playoffs and just really get out there and try to get back to the Super Bowl.
We were champs last year. He's not a champion yet this year, so it's still one of our main goals, and we're continuing to work and push to get there again.
Back in Indianapolis to start the third quarter, Al Michaels, John Madden, and Andrea Kramer. The final game of the 2007 NFL regular season. Final regular season game in this facility, because as you can see in that shot there, across the parking lot is the new Lucas Oil Stadium, which will open up with its retractable roof for the 2008 Indianapolis Colts season.
You know, they're going to tear this stadium down here, this facility, but they're not going to implode it. You know, and I always look forward to a good implosion. This building will be torn down, but it will not be imploded.
This is TJ Rushing. And Rushing, with a good run back, will take it back to the 40-yard line. Let's go to Andrea.
Well, Jeff Fisher seemed almost relieved at halftime when he said they weathered the storm with Peyton Manning, but they need offensive balance in the second half, and defensively, they can't give up any big plays. Now, the one injury concern the first half was Albert Haynesworth re-injuring that right hamstring. They stretched him throughout the first half. Jeff Fisher said he will play. As for Tony Dungy, he said they accomplished what they wanted in the first half, which included getting Reggie Wayne his 100-plus catches and the league receiving title.
Yeah, I think the only thing they didn't accomplish took place before the game when they couldn't get Marvin Harrison in uniform, and that was, according to Andrea, early on, a decision that was made by Tony Dungy and Bill Poley, and more than Marvin, at least.
Right, and the other thing, I think they want to be ahead. I mean, I think they'd be disappointed in, after Peyton Manning played and you take him out, that you're down 7-3.
Andrea will start third quarter, and Sorgi will get buried under an avalanche of on-rushing linemen and corners and linebackers. Cortland Finnegan comes from the outside, among others, in on the sack.
Well, I think they're going to have to, you know, change their game plan here. I mean, this is a Peyton Manning stuff they're trying to do, and obviously Jim Sorgi can't do it. You see, Cortland Finnegan is coming off the corner 31. He's not blocked, but they had about three guys get on Sorgi before Finnegan even got there.
Among other things, not only do you have the stars out, but you've got the leaders of the offensive line. And there goes another one, Tony Hugo, the rookie who's performed very well this season at left tackle for the retired Tarik Lent. He comes out, but Dylan Gandy is in Jeff Saturday's spot at center. Corey Hilliard replacing Jake Scott at one guard. Charlie Johnson still in there. Michael Deduz is now in at left tackle.
And see, now they have two backs, and to get this look, they put a back out here, one back in the backfield, and they split it back to get that three wide receiver look.
Here's Cofonzo Thorpe, and he'll get ridden down from behind by Steven Tulloch up at the 43-yard line. In the first half, Peyton Manning was in through the early stages of the second quarter, went over the 4,000-yard mark. Good opening drive by Tennessee. They marched down the field to get the touchdown, an 11-play drive. Reggie Wayne was in the game for only the first 25 minutes or so and caught 12 passes, and he will wind up leading the league in receiving yards this season, 1,510, if he doesn't play for the rest of the night, and it would figure to be the case. Third down and six now from the 43-yard line. Sorgi throws, and it'll be caught, but it'll be caught for next to no gain, and that will force a punting situation here. Michael Griffin in on the stop.
You know, this is the old deal, when the cat's away, the mice play. I mean, these are the types of defenses and blitzes and stuff that Peyton Manning would never see. Peyton Manning goes out, and you look, and you see what this offense would look like without Peyton Manning.
Hunter Smith. Chris Davis calls for and makes the fair catch at the 12-yard line. So Vince Young in the Titan offense We'll see their first action in the second half on the other side of the break. 7-3 Tennessee. Colts came to Indy from Baltimore back in 84. Before Manning, you can see the 14 years and the record. And then with Manning over the last 10 in this building. So they'll close down the RCA Dome. There it is, Lucas Oil Stadium, being built right across the parking lot. When you drive in to downtown Indianapolis, let's say from the south, from the airport, and you see that structure, it's massive. The RCA Dome looks like a little pimple next to it. It's amazing. From the 13-yard line, this is Lendale White picking up about three to the 16. And there it is. But you get the idea, especially from the green. Of course, John, you have never driven in from the airport, but you get the idea.
No, I see what you're talking about right now. I mean, the pimple is right here down in the lower part. And yeah. The big old thing's over there.
Yeah. We're in this pimple.
Which big old structure.
Right. Well, the RCA Dome is has the smallest capacity of any building in the league, a little under 60,000. The other building, I think, is going to hold about 71. And this is Lendale White again going nowhere, so it'll be third down and 7.
You know who's playing well for the Colt defense is number 99, Ed Johnson. I mean, he's the guy that, you know, we talk about that middle, that guy that controls the middle, and if you do control the middle, if you control right here, you'll control the running game. You see how he just starts right down? There's no place to go. He just takes away the hole, and Ed Johnson's been doing that all night.
Third and 8. Young rolling against the grain, and then he flips it, and it is caught inbounds by Eric Moles, the longtime Buffalo Bill, went to Houston last year and now winds up in Tennessee. So that's enough for a first down, so a third down conversion there. Rookies to start every game for the defending Super Bowl champs. There have only been four of them, and Ed Johnson would be the fourth of those. Logan Mankins, the great offensive lineman for the Patriots. Darrell Green, who might be going into the Hall of Fame as he becomes eligible for it. And Young throws, and that pass is caught. And forward progress might net a first down here for Roy Dell Williams.
And now the Titans can go about scoring because, you know, we talked about the Cataway, the mice play. Bob Sanders isn't in there now. So I think running is going to be a lot easier. I think getting to the perimeter is going to be a lot easier. I think when Vince Young scrambles, that's going to be a lot easier. And things that weren't there in the first half, I think he's going to find against this defense in the second half.
From the 38-yard line. The big bull is going to fumble it, and then it is picked up. And Indianapolis recovers it as Rocky Boyman, the former Tennessee Titan, makes a huge play on the fumble by White. Clinch Session, a rookie out of Pittsburgh. The linebacker was right in the middle of the action and may have forced the fumble.
I think it's number 55, Clint Session. I think he does get it. Watch him when he comes in right there. I think he knocks the ball out with his left arm. See Session come in right there. That's the thing, you just say that it's going to be different and someone steps up. You know, there's no Bob Sanders, but here comes a Clint Session making a big play.
So at the 30-yard line now, first down for the Indianapolis Colts after White's fifth fumble of the season. Sorgi's going to swing it out, and the pass is behind the intended receiver. The crowd wants a flag, and they're going to get it because Griffin hit him late. Dawson had to reach back, couldn't handle it. And then Michael Griffin, their number one pick out of Texas, comes in and draws the flag.
After the play was over, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, defense, number 33. Penalized 15 yards and a first down.
You know, you tend to get these calls on the other team's sideline. When you hit there, there's going to be some coach, there's going to be someone yelling, late hit, late hit. I'm not sure about that. That was awfully close, mm-hmm. But he didn't need it. I mean, it was a short pass. It was thrown poorly. It was behind him. And he really didn't have to have any contact.
Ball now with a 15, first and 10. Sorgi. And that pass is too high, intended for Devin Aromashadu. Sorgi goes down. Sorgi played his college football at Wisconsin. And, you know, they don't have a third quarterback. So if Sorgi got hurt, either you'd have to go back to Manning, or you could have Hunter Smith as the emergency quarterback, who's the punter.
I did ask that before the game, and Tony Dungy said if Sorgi were to get hurt, Peyton Manning would go back in the game. And if we're right at the end of the game, a couple minutes left, I mean, he may do the emergency thing. But if Sorgi got hurt now, Peyton Manning would go back in the game.
If I'm the Titans, I make sure Sorgi stays healthy.
I would hold him up like Albert Haynesworth just helped him up on that last play.
Second and 10. And a flag is thrown here as the pass is caught by Luke Lawton.
You know, you look at the Colts use four receivers. You know, two tight ends, two wide receivers, or three wide receivers. But of that tight end and wide receiver, they only have five active today. And they play four of them all the time. So when they take those guys out of the game, now they have to play backs at those positions.
Marvin Harrison inactive. Anthony Gonzalez is also inactive.
Illegal use of hands to the face. Defense, number 50. A 5-yard penalty and a first down.
Automatic.
That's David Thornton, the old Colt. He played here as a linebacker for the Colts and knows them well. He's the outside linebacker on this play right there. You see right here is what they call. There's the hands to the face right there.
That's going to make it first and goal with the nose of the ball on the 10-yard line.
Charlie Johnson, tight end.
And busting over left guard is Clifton Dawson. Free agent, rookie out of Harvard, making it second down and goal.
Isn't that something we're seeing more and more players from the Ivy League?
Yeah.
And more players like, you know, Cliff Dawson, there was a real good player at Harvard, and, you know, as a third running back here, and he's playing himself into a position that someday he may be the alternate back.
Right now he's the sole back in the seventh, second down and goal. And the pass is caught for a touchdown by Crofonzo Thorpe. The Lendale White fumble, the turnover, and all of a sudden, for the first time tonight, the Tennessee Titans find themselves trailing.
Sorgi makes a good throw. He gets back here quickly. Ronaldo Hill is a corner, and he's off too far. I mean, he just gave him that. But watch Sorgi. 1, 2, 3. Boom. The ball's out of there, and he hits him perfectly. The corner just gets in a position that you can't get in. You know, when you're down there in the goal line, you have to get up and hit him. You just can't give him that free slam.
Vinatieri for the point after. Colts capitalize on the turnover. 9:09 left in the third. And Indianapolis has the lead for the first time tonight. 10-7, the Colts are on top. Capitalizing on the turnover. The kickoff is fielded at the 3-yard line by Chris Henry. Oh, what a shot! The 22-yard line, a monster hit by Darrell Reed. 6'2 and 288.
All right, a defensive lineman, you usually don't even find these guys on cover team. Wow.
Henry must think he's in Fort Wayne right now. Darrell Reed is a defensive tackle, plays on special teams, does he ever. Somehow, some way, Chris Henry got up. I don't know how. We'll play it for you in real time in a second. A monster hit. Tennessee takes over at the 22-yard line on first down. Young off the fake. Floats one into the arms of Roy Dell Williams. Gain of 12 yards and then coming up with the ball. But after the whistle had sounded, there's no play here, was Michael Carr. Let's go back to the Reed bombing.
I think this was one of the biggest hits I've ever seen in my life. And if that were a heavyweight fight, he'd have to take a standing eight count. Oof. Look at Dallas Clark. He can't even look at it.
Even Tony Dungy. From the 36 on first down. Young throws, and that is Hall, the fullback who was in the Marines and then wound up playing at Texas. And in fact, he played there with Young and with Bo Scaife.
You want to look at that read hit one more time, Al?
I'm glad I'm looking at it, not absorbing it.
Oh. Pointing to the top of his head. It's all right.
Ooh,
there.
Boy. Second down and five. Henry thinking about going back on suspension after that.
I don't know why his eyes aren't blinking.
It's caught out in the flat by Eric Moles. Moles comes up a couple of yards shy of the first down, making it third down and two. So about halfway through the third quarter, again, the situation very simple. Tennessee wins. They go to the playoffs at San Diego next Sunday. They lose. End of season. Cleveland goes to San Diego.
Yeah, I think Tennessee's doing what they have to. I mean, they just had that fumble. You know, run the ball, play action pass, get the ball out quickly to your wide receivers, do those kinds of things. But you can't afford the turnover.
Third and two. And Young is able to push his way to a first down as he was able to push Amano out of the way. Melvin Bullitt comes in to make the tackle that will move the chains. First down up at the 47-yard line.
That's what Titan fans don't want to see is Vince Young limping, because they do need those legs. I think, you know, as I said earlier, if they're going to win the game, he's going to have to make some plays running the ball, just like he does here. It's a third down. He gets that thing. As you said, pushes the lineman out of the way, gets a first down.
And he is a little gimpy. Kerry Collins, the longtime veteran, is the backup quarterback for Tennessee. And now it looks like Young is going to have to come out of the game.
He's going to take himself out.
Because he limps off to the sideline, and Kerry Collins, the 13-year veteran out of Penn State, who comes in to mentor and tutor Young. Young is down on the field for an injury timeout. Collins in when we come back. We're back as Young is in agony. We'll show you the replay. There's nothing that is that apparent, but Kerry Collins comes into the game on second down and 10 from the 47-yard line. Collins, who started one game this season in October against the Houston Texans, completes his first pass, and that's a first down. Ahmad Hall, the fullback, as we go back to take a look right now at the play with Young and to see where he winds up getting hurt. It's tough to discern.
I think it's his lower left leg is the part that it looked like they were working on.
Grabbed by Bullitt. Melvin Bullitt had it as it went down, and now on first down, this is Chris Henry, who took that humongous shot from Reed, and he gets tackled here by Brandon Archer after a gain of a couple. And there they are working on Young, who missed a game with a quad strain, that Houston game that Collins started. A game the Titans had a huge lead, blew it, and then won it at the end on a Baronis field goal, 38-36.
It looked like they were just stretching the leg out,
yeah,
doesn't it? I wonder if it was a quad thing again, or you know what you would hope for if you're a Titan fan, you would hope it's a cramp. You know, and that does happen in these indoor stadiums. You know, players do tend to dehydrate. And, again, that's just guessing. But this changes the game. I mean, you know, it was going to be that, you know, the Titans were going to need Vince Young at the end of the game, you know, to run, to use his legs, to make some big plays running the ball. Now they're not going to get that from Kerry Collins.
Third down and eight from the 41-yard line. Good protection. Collins throws. That's caught. That'll be a first down, and he has them in field goal range right now. Eric Moles to the 28-yard line. And this is Bullitt who's slow in getting up. 14-yard gain here.
Yeah, they like Eric Moles as a third wide receiver or the slot receiver. Here, the Colts are just playing off. Moles just go up there, goes up where he knows that he has a first down, sits down. This shows Kerry Collins' numbers. Now I think they could mix in the run. You know, kind of go back to that, I think, would be a good strategy for the Titans. Don't get away from the run, but don't have your right tackle, Dave Stewart, big country, jump off sides either.
False start. Offense number 76. 5-yard penalty. It remains first down.
6'7", 318 is big country. See if Young can come back. At least he's up right now. Collins, meanwhile, with a ton of experience, obviously. Go back to when he was the quarterback for the Carolina Panthers in his second season in existence and took them to the NFC Championship game, one game from the Super Bowl. And of course, and, to play with the Giants.
Right, and he can't run a lick, so it has to be either, you know, the running game carrying this or Kerry Collins throwing the ball.
First and 15 right now. And Collins was, he was the
offense. Yard penalty. It remains first down.
It's a delay of game right here. Collins did get a team to the Super Bowl. That was when he was with the Giants. He went there in 99 after a stop at New Orleans as well, then to Oakland for a couple of years. He was the starting quarterback for the Raiders for 2 years and then to Tennessee last season. And now he's put in a position where he may be the guy that has to get them to the playoffs.
They can still run the ball. It's still first down. The Colts are in five defensive backs and nickel.
First and 20. Over the middle. Making the catch. Getting back some of the yardage. Chris Henry to the 30. Let's go to Andrea.
Well, no official word yet from the Titans, but they were stretching Vince Young's right quadricep when he was on the ground. Now, he did miss, as you guys alluded to, one game earlier this season with that same quad strain. Right now, he's just walking around trying to walk it off, but no official word yet. We'll keep you posted.
Meanwhile, Collins in the game. Well, we've seen what Todd Collins can do. He let Washington to the playoffs, and let's see what Kerry Collins can now do. His team down by three, second and 12, and all of a sudden, after no penalties through the first quarter and a half, an array of them.
Encroachment. Defense number 90. A 5-yard penalty. Remains second down.
Dan Klecko.
Yeah, he just got five of those yards back, and that's what an experienced quarterback will do. He'll go in there and he'll change the cadence. You know, and the defense has been used to, you know, jumping the count, jumping the cadence. You know, you bring in a veteran quarterback like Kerry Collins, and just the change of inflection in his voice will sometimes draw the defense off.
Second and 7. And again, this is Henry going next to nowhere, stopped at the 22-yard line. That's Darrell Reed revisioning with Henry. The hit on the run back.
He's gonna have nightmares about Reed, isn't he?
Yeah, Henry, no matter where Henry turns, there's Reed.
And that's a pretty good one too.
That was
no love tap.
Henry thrilled that Reed is out of the game for the moment. Third down and 5. Collins. That pass is incomplete. That was Jeff Charleston who came in and deflected it. So it's fourth down and 5. And Baronis, who kicked 8 field goals in a game earlier this season to beat Houston in the game Collins start, will come in to try to tie the game.
Hey, you see right there, he gets hit just as he's throwing it. Jeff Charleston comes from that backside, and he's reaching around, again, reaching for the shoulder and or arm and or ball.
32 field goals for Baronis, most in the league. 40 yards to try to tie the game. Hendrick puts it down. The kick is good. So with 16 minutes and 5 seconds left in regulation and maybe the season, it's 10-10 in Indianapolis. .105 left in the third as this kickoff will be downed in the end zone by Aroma Shadu, and let's go to Andrea.
Well, the official word from the Titans is what I had mentioned before. They are calling Vince Young's injury a quad strain and his return questionable. They continue to stretch him right now on the ground. And one thing that comes to mind for me, guys, is something that Norm Chow told us last night, which is that Vince Young is still a little bit immature. And when things don't go well for him, he lets them linger and pouts. So he's got some personal things as well as physical things to overcome at this moment.
There is Norm Chow, the offensive coordinator who was at USC when Lendale White, Reggie Bush, and Matt Leinart, and those guys there working under Pete Carroll. And it was that quad that kept Young from starting the one game that he did not start this season, and Collins did. 1:05 to go in the period as the pass from Sorgi is caught for a gain of 7 on the outside by Crofonzo Thorpe, making it 2nd down and 3.
Yeah, I don't think what Vince Young is going through right now has anything to do with pouting. It's about, you know, can the leg work? Can he run? Because the Titans need Vince Young now. You know, and they were going to need his legs and need him running in the fourth quarter. And the way he's limping around there doesn't look like they're going to have him. You can just tell by the look in their eyes, the way they kind of shake their head. I don't feel that Vince Young will be back.
2nd down and 3 from the 27-yard line. Sorgi gets it away, and that is caught by Aroma Shadu. Flag. Aroma Shadu up to the 42. The penalty marker was thrown at the 33-yard line.
An eligible man downfield. Number 72 offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat 2nd down.
Corey Hilliard is a rookie out of Oklahoma State, the backup right guard to Jake Scott, and there goes Young to the locker room.
Sometimes you can do things in the locker room on a table and so on that you can't do out in the field. So they're probably taking one last quick shot to be able to get Vince Young back.
And that will be the end of the third quarter in Indianapolis. Tennessee's playoff hopes on the line. The game is tied at 10. Sunday Night Football back after these messages. Tonight's aerial coverage being brought to you by Gillette Clinical Strength. As we come back to the capital of the state of Indiana, Al Michaels, John Madden, and Andrea Kramer, the final quarter of the regular season, barring overtime. By the way, not that it would happen, because it hasn't happened in 5 years. If this game wound up in a tie, that would be great for Cleveland, because that would put them into the playoffs. A tie, or clearly a Tennessee loss. We'll start the period here with Kent and Keith on a 2nd down and 8, taking it up to about the 23-yard line.
We were talking to Peyton Manning the other day, and he knew he wasn't going to play the whole game, but he said he was going to do everything that he could when he wasn't in the game to help him win. And he is. I mean, he's as involved as a coach. In fact, he looks like a coach now, doesn't he? I mean, he has Jim Sorgi up there. He's talking to him right in his face, you know, giving him everything that, you know, that he has to have. Any way that he can help Jim Sorgi, Peyton Manning's going to help him.
Well, if he wanted to be a coach when his career is over, there's no question he could do it. 3rd down and 7, probably be, I would think, tremendously successful. Sorgi throws, that's caught, and it's going to be a 1st down as Luke Lawton, to the cries of Luke, picks up the 1st down.
They're not saying boo, they're saying Luke, huh?
They like Lawton, second-year guy out of McNeese State. Joseph Adai out of the game, Keith's his backup. Lawton's seen more and more action, and we've also seen Clifton Dawson.
And again, that's in lieu of tight ends and wide receivers, because the Colts only have one tight end now. Myron Fletcher, you see number 81 in there, that's in the slot right now. So they have to use their backs as receivers.
Sorgi going deep, and it's almost intercepted. Michael Griffin looks at his hands and asks, "Why did you desert me?" Right in his hands, the pass intended for Thorpe.
Yeah, they were in the cover three, which is three deep, and you see Michael Griffin, he's just the middle guy here. And he goes right down the hash, and again, he can get from sideline to sideline. He gets a good jump on that ball, great position, and like you said, his hands just deserted him. Or maybe because of those hands he's looking at. That's why he's a defensive player.
Meanwhile, Steven Tulloch, there he is, the starting middle linebacker. He is going out. Colin Allred comes in. Tulloch is taking the spot of Ryan Fowler, who's on injured reserve. But down to the guy who was number three on the depth chart, a middle linebacker, before Fowler got hurt. And that pass is incomplete, intended for Thorpe, setting up a third down and 10. In the AFC, very simply, New England at 16-0, clearly on top as the number one seed. Indy is two, and there's your wild card situation. Tennessee or Cleveland goes to San Diego Sunday. We have the Jacksonville-Pittsburgh game in primetime on Saturday night. And then New England faces the lowest seeded team that remains. So if San Diego, in other words, if San Diego wins, no matter who they play, they go to Indianapolis, and then the other survivor would go to New England in the second round. Sorgi throws, and that pass is incomplete, intended for Thorpe, and it will be fourth down, and in comes Hunter Smith and his gang.
Yeah, congratulations to the Patriots. I mean, that was a great game last night with the Giants, and kind of proud of both of them. And there's a shot of Raymond Berry, the great Hall of Fame wide receiver that was a Baltimore Colt. What a player he was. Okay. You know, you talk about a guy that had moves and hands and studied the game. He was a wide receiver that had a mindset a lot like Peyton Manning.
Goes down in NFL lore, Unitas to Berry. 10-yard line. This is Chris Davis bringing it back up to the 20. And a flag is down all the way back at the Colt 38-yard line.
During the kick, holding number 56 of the return team. That'll be penalized half the distance from the goal at the end of the kick. First down.
Back him up close to the 10-yard line. 13-11 left in regulation. Everything on the line for Tennessee. 10-10. As we come back, it's a live shot of Young just walking out of the locker room and through the tunnel out onto the field, but not looking like a guy who's going to play anytime soon, certainly tonight or at all, even though he's in uniform. He's going to try to jog over to the bench, but Kerry Collins will start this drive from the 6-yard line.
I think it's good that he came back, still has his uniform on, and right towards the end there started a jog. I think that would be a little positive thing.
Lendale White picks up about 3 yards, getting up to the 9-yard line.
And I know the type of game that Jeff Fisher wants to play. I mean, he wants to, you know, still take time off the clock, time of possession, keep the ball away from the Colts. It's not as important now with Jim Sorgi in there, but, you know, not have a turnover, not take any big chances in this area of the field.
Well, that one turnover was the one that killed him, leading to Indy's only touchdown. And that's a gain of a couple out to the 10-yard line for White, setting up a pretty key, even though it's early in the period, third down and 6. And it's key in the sense that if they don't pick up the first down, they're going to have to punt from deep in their own territory. And the Colts would figure to be working with a short field and a tie game.
Right, and then I think if they had that good field position, which they probably would get, they could just go to their running game heavy.
Third and 6. And Collins completes it. Now, where are they going to spot it? Right on the yellow line. This is Roy Dell Williams making the catch across the line, and that would appear to be enough for a first down. And is.
Look at that. This was a dangerous throw here because that corner is awfully close to him. You know, and it's where his forward motion is stopped, right there. So the ball should be spotted right there, right in front of that red, white, and blue line.
Just enough for a first down. At the 17-yard line, first and 10. Collins with that fake. And then Gage makes the catch, and he's up to the 36-yard line.
Good play action fake by Kerry Collins here. I mean, he really held those linebackers in there so he could get to Gage. Watch how this affects the defense and holds them all right there so that Gage can get in behind them. So he holds them just enough that he comes out of the play action pass and he has a perfect lane.
Sold it beautifully. 19-yard gain. Now to the 36-yard line. To the ground. And White gets taken down. That's a nice play in the backfield. That's Melvin Bullitt making his presence felt tonight, a rookie out of Texas A&M.
You know, and he's Bob Sanders B. When they take Bob Sanders out, they put Bullitt in. And you see he's right up here, just like Sanders would play, on the line of scrimmage, that eighth guy up. And not only does he line up there to take away the run, but he himself takes away the run.
Ticking down to 10 minutes to play in the fourth. And that pass is caught. Going to be a little short of the first down. That's Gage, who's coming up big on this series. Justin Gage, fifth year, played with the Chicago Bears, came over as a free agent this season.
Yeah, again, a big wide receiver that can run those slants or, you know, use his body to catch that ball. And Gage did that. I mean, that was a pretty good catch because that was a little low and behind him. And usually you like that slant right up there around your numbers so that you can catch it and run right through the defense or have a chance to.
Gave him a real nice spot on that. Looked like he had come up about a half yard shy. Instead, it's very close to a first down as they bring the chains out. And Ron Winter so signals first down for the Tennessee Titans.
Kerry Collins is doing his job. I mean, this is you know, it's a tough job being a backup quarterback. You don't get a lot of reps in practice, and sometimes you get no reps, and then you have to be ready. Anytime, you know, the starter goes down, you have to come in and perform big time and on a big stage as Kerry Collins is right now.
John trying to work out the soreness on the bike. The ball is at the 46-yard line. This is Henry going to the outside. And he's able to get around the first guy, Bullitt, but not the second and third who come in, including Brandon Archer, the middle linebacker. That'll be a gain of one, second and nine.
I think Rocky Bauman is down there in the thing. But this Colt defense, you know, the thing that Tony Dungy and Ron Meeks always talk about is to play fast and play hard. And they're doing both well.
Wild Card Saturday next week. Football Night starts things 4 o'clock Eastern. Washington against Seattle, followed by Jacksonville and Pittsburgh. The lineup next week. After the Boyman injury, he goes to the sideline. Bo Scaife makes the catch, and the tight end takes the ball to the 40-yard line of the Colts before Brandon Archer makes the stop.
You know, they're running a lot more screens like that to a tight end. Watch Bo Scaife. He's right here, and he's going to block. And now come out. And while he was blocking, that let this happen. Let the linemen get downfield, get their blocks, and then he can get right in behind them. That was a very good play, a well-timed play. And Scaife blocked just long enough to let his linemen get down.
From the 41-yard line, the Titans on a first and 10. Collins going deep, and that pass is incomplete. He tries to go to Justin Gage. He's covered on the play by T.J. Rushing. It'll be second and 10 with 8:18 to play.
I think he tried to drill that into a very, very tight window. I know that they're trying to get a big play on first down because, you know, we talked about the Colts and how they play that eight man up. Well, when you have eight men up, that means you're man to man or you have those corners out there on the wide receiver. So it's a good chance to throw that slant like they've been doing. It's also a good chance to go play action pass and try and get the deep one like they just did.
Second and 10. The rookie Henry on a delay. The rookie out of Arizona, their second round draft choice, gets tackled by another rookie, Ed Johnson.
And now they're getting very close to pretty good field goal range. I'd say they need, you know, this would be what, 50? 52, 53, 54 yards.
Right. Certainly in Baronis' range, but the downside to that is if you try it, you miss it, then you give Indianapolis the ball at midfield.
Yeah, I think the Titans would like to get another first down at least.
Absolutely. Third down and five from the 36-yard line. Collins throws into traffic, and that's incomplete. You had three blue shirts surrounding Roydell Williams, among them was Michael Coe. So now Fisher has to make the choice here, and he is, for the moment, going to send out Baronis.
Yeah, I think right here, Kerry Collins just threw this one away. I mean, he looked, he felt the pressure, and then he knew that, you know, that clock in your head that these quarterbacks have, he knew there was time. I have to get that ball out of here. He didn't have a chance for a completion.
Baronis now a 54-yard attempt. Tremendous leg. Career-long 60 to beat the Colts. And the kick is good. Rob Baronis, clutch, very clutch. 54 yards, halfway through the quarter. Tennessee up by 3. The RCA Dome, some Cleveland fans here expressing their love for their team. And, of course, loving their team means that Indianapolis has to beat Tennessee tonight. The Titans have just retaken the lead. And the kickoff here will be fielded in a couple of hops and then dropped and then recollected by T.J. Rushing. And Rushing will work to the outside. And then finally Griffin is there to get in his face at the 18-yard line. A lot of hits tonight in this game, boy, including that monster whack, which I'm sure is part of this package by Reed on Henry. But there may not be anything at stake for Indianapolis, but they're still going to whack you.
I think that's all about a division rivalry. I mean, these teams know each other so well. They play each other twice every year. And just talking to both sides, you know that there's no love lost, that neither one of these teams really like the other.
It's the way it should be in a division, right? And it's a heck of a division, too, because when you think about it, if Tennessee gets in, that's three of the four teams that get in. Houston wins today and winds up at 500.
I remember when Tony Dungy first came here, he said the first thing we have to do is we have to overtake Tennessee. They were the dominant team in the division. He said that's the first thing we have to do is get better than they are. And, of course, they've done that and many, many other things.
Ooh, and then Sorgi's going to get planted by Antoine Odom, who comes up with the ball after he plants him. The play whistle to a halt, but he goes down for a sack, and that's a 7-yard sack, and it's going to make it second down and 17.
Antoine Odom is going to come from right here, and you see Sorgi's holding the ball a little too long. You know, we talk about that clock that has to go off in your head. I mean, he has to know by now you had better get rid of that thing, or you're going to get planted just like that. I think, you know, even before that passer, I think that the Colts can't get away from their running game. I mean, Jim Sorgi can't take them down in the passing game, of course, so they have to mix in the runs, screens, those kinds of things.
And the runner on second down and 17, and this is Clifton Dawson. So it's going to be third down now and 16. What a turn of events. And I'll tell you about when you go back to that last Tennessee drive, that third down play from deep in their own territory, that very first down, which they just did get on the pass to Williams. And that got them going. They were able to get into range for Baronis to kick that 54-yarder. And there was the guy who did it, Kerry Collins.
And that's what a backup quarterback has to do. He has to come in and not give up any bad plays and make a couple of big ones.
Sorgi is able to get it out. And this is Luke Lawton, who will only get to the 21 and come up about 7 yards shy of a first down. So in comes the punting unit as we tick down under 6 minutes to play in the fourth.
Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, Jim Sorgi is not the type of quarterback that can take a sack on first down and then and end up with second and long and third and long and get his offense out of it.
Hunter Smith, who normally doesn't see very much action when you're the punter for the Colts, quite often you don't even need a shower at the end of the game. Fifth punt fielded at the 40 by Chris Davis, and he'll step out of bounds in Colt territory at the 47-yard line. 5:21 remaining. Titans by 3. Jeff Fisher, sometimes it seems, has been around 1,000 years. He's still not 50 years old. They're the guys with the most victories before the age of 50, led by Bill Cowher. Jeff right now ending his 13th full season, plus he coached six games back in 94, longest in tenure with one team. His team right now, 5 minutes and 21 seconds away from going to the playoffs, trying to hold on to a three-point lead, and they start with a run here. Lendale White, as they try to churn up as much of the clock as they can, and we check in with Andrea Kramer.
Well, you guys said that the Browns are sweating it. I've been text messaging with Willie McGinnis, who said he's at the edge of his seat, excited that they still have a chance. He's at home watching it. Now, the one thing that he did tell me earlier is that at least they can take some pride in the fact that they advanced to 10-6 this season and that they can build for the future. But right now, he's just sweating it out at home.
Each of these teams would wind up at 10-6, but Tennessee would own the tiebreak. And that pass is caught. And out of bounds goes Bo Scaife, which is helpful to Cleveland's cause right now, the more they can get the clock stopped.
I don't think if you're the Cleveland Browns, you want to be thinking about the future now. You want to be thinking about what the Titans are doing or what the Colts are doing right here. Because if the Colts could come up and beat the Titans, then, again, that would put the Browns in the playoffs. So you can wait until this one's over before you start worrying about next year.
Third down and six. We're really on the edge of the seat in Cleveland, and that's a first down, a big first down. Justin Gage is able to pick up the first. That's going to let him take more time off the clock, and they're already in Barona's field goal range. That's an 11-yard gain.
T.J. Rushing is the corner on this side, and he's off too far. You can see what happened is Gage just goes up. He knows where that first down marker is. He gets up beyond the first marker, and Kerry Collins hits him with the out. Gage, again, not great speed, but a big body, and he knows how to use the body. And both of these quarterbacks are using him as their go-to guy tonight.
First and 10. Gage has caught seven passes for 104 yards. And that clock churning time again here. Henry, rookie coming off a four-game suspension, and a guy who took that tremendous wallop from Reed before, and they've got him in the game here in crunch time.
You know, Jeff Fisher was talking about him last night and thinking that he would be a good change of pace because he has more speed. You know, that Lendale White, Chris Brown, kind of the inside guys, and maybe they could get Chris Henry in there and get him in the outside.
On second and 10, Collins is going to fling it to the outside and complete it. And it's Roydell Williams who gets taken out of bounds by Michael Coe. But that moves the chains again. First down at the 20-yard line.
That is a heck of a throw by Kerry Collins. I mean, there's not a big window there. There's not a wide open space. I mean, look how short that window is between where his receiver is and the defender is. And he has to jam that ball in there. He made the perfect pass.
Saluted by Young.
Should be.
Henry.
And now Kerry Collins wants to slow everything down here. He got those first downs, and now, you know, just keep the ball on the ground. You know, use the full clock.
Heard the whistles, a little bit of a skirmish, but not enough to stop the play. And now Collins, who's been here before, Kerry 13 seasons in the league, knows how to milk it. He'll milk that play clock all the way down, or should. Second down and six at the 16-yard line.
And you'd like to run the ball, but run the ball successfully.
And again to the 15. And a third down here, and the Colts now will begin to think about taking their timeouts, and they do right here, their first. 30th night of December. Wish you all a very happy new year, and we'll gather again with you next Saturday, Wild Card Saturday, with a doubleheader. Redskins against the Seahawks to open it. Jaguars and the Steelers in the nightcap.
Yeah, big third down here for both teams, but I would think that Kerry Collins has a pass here, and I would imagine for Justin Gage. I mean, the closer you get to the goal line, the more important that big body is. Where The guy could use his body against a defender and Gage is that guy.
Gage splits wide to the right. Roydell Williams comes to the left. And they're going to run it with Henry. And Henry's going to get tripped up. So at least Indianapolis is going to hold him to a field goal attempt. And Indianapolis will also, at this particular point, use their second timeout. So what's going to happen here is if Baronis kicks the field goal, it'll be a six-point game. There'll be a little less than 3 minutes to go. And the Colts will have one timeout plus the two-minute warning. So that's plenty of time when you consider how much time remains on the clock as Baronis tries to make it a six-point game.
Right. I liked what the Titans did on first and second down. I think running, taking time off the clock, milking the clock, those kinds of things I think were good. I think they had to take a shot on third down for a first down with the passing game. Because Kerry Collins is hot. I mean, you know, he has something going. He's confident. You know, he looks like, you know, he can get it done. Justin Gage is getting open, so I think they would have had a shot there.
Collins 10 out of 13 for 106 yards. Baronis now. This will be a 33-yard attempt. Earlier, he was good from 54. Patrick to spot it. And that kick is good inside the left upright with 2 minutes and 56 seconds remaining in the fourth quarter. So the game started out tonight with first unit guys going on both sides, such as they were. Indy, of course, with a lot of guys inactive tonight. Manning and Wayne combined, with Reggie winding up catching a total of 12 passes, some of those from Sorgi. Vince Young came out with a quad injury with 6:01 left in the third, and so the veteran Kerry Collins had to come in. And as we say, you think about it's the month of the Collinses. Jason Campbell gets hurt for Washington. In comes Todd Collins, and what a masterful job he did as they end the season with a four-game winning streak to get to the playoffs. And now you've got Kerry Collins coming in here for Young. We don't know about Young. If Tennessee gets to San Diego, of course, that'll be one of the key issues of the week. Can he play? How much can he play? But the last three possessions for Tennessee have resulted in three Baronis field goals.
And I'm impressed with Kerry Collins, how calm he was. I mean, he's a 13-year veteran, and he's playing like one. I mean, he hasn't always had the most confidence in those 13 years, but he sure is playing confidently tonight.
And Baronis sends one down toward the Colt end zone. It's going to be fielded by T.J. Rushing. 2 yards in. Rushing out past the 20 and to the 25-yard line. With 2 minutes and 50 seconds remaining in the fourth quarter. Haynesworth coming back out onto the field. Vanderbosch coming back out onto the field. Tulloch, who went to the locker room, he's coming back onto the field. They're trying to go to San Diego.
Right. And this is where you define good defense. You know, people talk about, you know, defense, number one against the run, number one against the, you know, when you need good defense right now to win the game, to get in the playoffs, that's good defense. And that's what the Titans need right now.
From the 25-yard line, Luke Lawton, the setback. Sorgi in the pocket, throws high and incomplete. And a flag is down. Devin Aroma should do, the intended receiver. You're going to have a false start against the Colts.
Illegal formation. Offense. Penalties declined. Makes it second down.
The same sign, but it's a different penalty in as much as if it's a false start, the play wouldn't have counted. But an illegal formation, which is that same signal, results in a play being run and then the penalty not accepted. So it's second down and 10 instead of first and 15.
Titans have five defensive backs in there, and they're playing a form of cover two deep safeties with nickel.
Sorgi stepping up, buys time, and then the pass is incomplete. Aroma Shadu was there, and then Lawton was behind him. And it will be third down and 10.
That was an ugly pass. It looked like Sorgi was trying to throw to the left first. Then he came back to the right and threw it through one guy and then through another guy.
Paul Justin, last guy before Manning to lead a fourth quarter comeback drive for this team.
I was just saying that the Colts are starting to look like an offense who's playing with all backups.
Yes.
I mean, your guys aren't in the right positions. They're not in the right formation. Two guys together in the pass pattern. All those things that shouldn't happen in a pro football game in week 17.
Looks like August the 20th. That's Thorpe making the catch, and that's going to be a loss on the play as Vincent Fuller is right there. And now you have fourth down. Fourth and 11. The clock is still ticking. You have one timeout plus the two-minute warning. And so Tony Dungy at this point, he's almost compelled to go for it.
Tony Dungy at this point ought to give Peyton Manning a raise. And you just look at the Colts with Peyton Manning, who they are, what they are, what they can do, and without Peyton Manning. Of course, they're without a lot of other guys, too. I know that.
They just get it off before the two-minute stoppage. Sorgi firing, and the pass is not caught. It was almost hauled in by Aroma Shadu. It looked like he was coming down with it, but Lowry was right there, and with every heart stopped on the shores of Lake Erie for a second, they come that close, but he can't come down with it, and Tennessee has the ball. Two-minute warning. And that's what you'll have with the Colts not worried about wild card weekend. Their next action will be here in 2 weeks. Meanwhile, Tennessee, a minute and 54 seconds away from a trip to San Diego where they would face the Chargers next Sunday afternoon. Indianapolis can only stop the clock once. The ball is at the 24-yard line. And that's your last stoppage right there with a minute and 52 seconds. Minute still going down. And in fact, the Colts,
you see, Jeff
are not
Fisher,
going to take their time out.
I was just saying, Jeff Fisher over there talking to Vince Young. I'm sure he's talking to him about next week. You know, is this, how long is this thing going to last?
Well, the only thing I'd say here, not that it's going to really make that much of a difference. If you take your time out, you still are going to force them to run a fourth down play of some sort before they could run the clock out. But if you're not going to take your time out, or maybe they'll take it here.
Well, say that they do. And say that they do get the ball back with a couple seconds. They still have Jim Sorgi and all the backups.
But you know what?
They can't get a first down.
They have to make a fourth down play, but that's going to be moot right now because they're just going to let the clock run all the way down, or at least take maybe the timeout prior to fourth down. You have third down coming up right here.
And they haven't told the Titans because the Titans are celebrating victory.
They are, but they're going to take it. They're going to take it on fourth down, I assume. This is about a 30-second differential between the game clock and the play clock, and they don't even do it here. That's surprising because we've seen crazy things happen in football games, and I'm just surprised they didn't do it. At least force them into a situation where you had to snap the ball on fourth down and do something.
Right, because there can always be a turnover. They can fumble a snap. We've seen all those things. And, it's just like, playing a full game, playing every game to win, playing every game for 60 minutes. And sometimes we forget those things.
Yep. In the meantime, it's Kerry Collins leading his team. That big third down conversion deep in his own territory was gigantic. Baronis kicks the three field goals. Two of them are the difference. Tennessee wins, and on to the playoffs they go. Post game show next.